Hello, everybody. Welcome, everybody. Thank you for joining us in this masterclass with Petra Costa. I don't think that Petra Costa needs any introduction at all. She's one of the most interesting and diverse filmmakers working right now. And we thought that it would be a great opportunity to talk with her, since as a filmmaker, she has been challenging since her very first films the notion itself of what it means today to work in the so-called field of documentary. With me is my colleague Delphine Jeanneret, and we are very happy and honored to have Petra Costa with us. This masterclass is hosted and organized in a joint venture with the head in Geneva. During the masterclass, the audience will have the opportunity to ask Petra questions, and we will forward your questions to Petra. This edition of Visions du Réel will go down in history. We didn't plan to have an online edition because we are staunch supporters of the physical event of the festival. That said, the response that we had to our shifting our festival online has been nothing short but overwhelming. And we are truly, truly, truly grateful to all of you who support our festival, that watched the films, participated in the online activities, because it's basically you that kept this festival alive with your warmth, with your being close to the festival, with your support. And obviously there's a big, big thank you to the technical staff of Visions du Réel that allowed in no time, literally no time, to move all the operations of the festival online. These people have been working non-stop, tirelessly, relentlessly, to make it possible for you to have access to the festival with just one click from your laptop. So this is a huge thank you for our technical team. And I would again, thank you. Thank Petra Costa for being here with us today. It means the world to us to be here with you in this specific moment where we are experiencing this extremely new situation where we are confined in our home because of a pandemic, which obviously is already a question of how we reorganize our social life, how we share our informations, and this is basically a question also of democracy. And your work as a filmmaker challenged these notions, but we will go back to that later on. This was only to say that we are grateful and honored to have you here with us. So I think I said my piece. Delphine, to you.
Thank you very much, Jonah, for this nice introduction. Hello everyone. So I would like also to thank Visions du Réel on behalf of Geneva School of Art and Design, Head Genève, for the opportunity to collaborate on this atelier for now many years, because it's really a tremendous occasion for our students, whom I warmly welcome here, by the way, to discover filmmakers like Petra Costa, whose films are really part of the most interesting and challenging works in contemporary cinema, documentary cinema. So maybe to start with Petra, I think it would be very interesting to hear how you came to filmmaking, because you did not study it as such, but rather you came to it through a pluridisciplinary approach. And I think it would be interesting to start off with this background.
Mm-hmm. Well, first, thank you very much, Delphine. Thank you, Jonah. Thank you, Emily and Vision du Réel, for being a festival that is constantly pushing the boundaries of storytelling in the documentary art form. And unfortunately, I was not able to come and be there with you physically, but I'm happy we can do this virtually, at least. Do you hear me well?
Perfect.
Yes.
Okay. Yes, I did not study film. I actually thought it was too much of a luxury to study film, and something that I couldn't even dare to imagine myself as a filmmaker coming of age. It was, I would only see and hear about male filmmakers and from very distant realities. And I started actually in theater. And since a very young age, my sister was an actress, and I started acting since the age of 14. And in theater, really loved the workshopping scenes, like the possibility of creating and improvising scenes in a group, and through those scenes, creating a play or investigating themes. And I worked a little bit. I had the chance of having classes with Antonio Araújo, who is a theater director in Brazil, very inspired by the contemporary, like avant-garde theaters movements in the United States and in Europe as well. And one of the main things him and his theater group taught me was that to approach that which I felt most ashamed of. And that stayed with me as an inspiration. But I felt theater alone. I went to study theater university, but then felt theater alone was not really, did not give me the tools to understand Brazil and its complexities and to know what I wanted to be able to speak about and express. And I wanted to study more of philosophy, history, psychology, to be able to even write a play and or perform in a play. And I managed to transfer to Barnard, Columbia University, and there did a liberal arts training and a concentration in anthropology. And it was wonderful. I had a very inspiring class, many inspiring classes there. One of the most inspiring with Bruce Robbins in comparative literature that introduced me to Benjamin, Kant, Nietzsche, Marx, Freud. And those were precisely the kind of background elements I was missing. And also anthropology was very enriching, the possibility of getting to know my country through ethnography. And it was through anthropology that I started filming, and visual anthropology that I started trying to produce. And that then I met cinema and found in cinema a way of combining my interest in theater and in anthropology.
So I think we could start now with watching the first excerpt of the films that we prepared, which is the excerpt from Elena. It's your first feature film from 2012, and it's based on the life of the actress Elena Andrade, who is your older sister. So let's watch this first excerpt.
And how old are you?
20.
20. And how tall are you?
5'9" and a half.
Okay. You were born in Brazil?
I was born in Brazil.
Uh-huh.
And I've been here almost a year and a half now.
What brought you to come to the United States?
I was doing theater there since I was 14 years old. And then the possibilities in Brazil are like either you continue doing theater, which, I mean, there are very few productions, or you do soaps.
Uh-huh.
I was invited to do, I mean, after a while that I was in theater, but I don't even like it.
You wanted to do other things besides
theater? I wanted to
theater.
Do films.
Film, right.
And in Brazil, it's like practically almost none, you know, mm-hmm. especially now that the system changed there. The president's like one movie a year and that.
Do do your parents, are they involved in this business at all? Or
No. My mom is a journalist and sociologist. She has a newspaper there. And my father is a politician. Mm-hmm. He lives in Belo Horizonte.
Na verdade, o nosso pai sempre diz que eu e você herdamos esse sonho de fazer cinema da nossa mãe. E no meio das suas fitas de vídeo, eu achei esse filme, que ela nunca me mostrou. É um filme mudo, em que ela interpreta a protagonista, no tempo em que ela ainda sonhava em ser atriz de Hollywood e em beijar o Frank Sinatra. Assim, se sentia mulher. Tentava escapar de um mundo em que se via desadaptada, incompreendida. Filha de uma tradicional família mineira, ela não via um lugar para si, a não ser casada, mulher, society. Um dia, sentada em frente ao espelho da penteadeira do seu quarto, ela faz um desenho. O desenho da sua tristeza. E decide que tem até os 16 anos para encontrar um sentido para a vida. E ela encontra o nosso pai, um brasileiro recém-chegado do país com qual ela sonha, em filmes e músicas. Mas ele volta de Nova York, não como um Sinatra, mas como um Che Guevara. Trazendo no bolso os livros de Marx e o desejo de fazer revolução. E da noite pro dia, nossa mãe deixa a escola de freiras, vende sua televisão, seu cabelo e pula para as passeatas. Juntos, eles entram no PCdoB, prontos para serem mandados para a guerrilha do Araguaia. Mas quando os líderes veem a barriga de 6 meses da nossa mãe, eles não deixam eles irem. Quase todos que foram acabaram assassinados pelos militares. Foi você, na barriga da nossa mãe, que o salvou. No meio desse redemoinho, você nasce e cresce clandestina, sem nunca poder contar pra ninguém onde mora. Como será que esse tempo ficou na sua memória, no seu corpo? As primeiras imagens que eu acho de você são de quando você fez 13 anos e ganhou essa câmera de presente.
Ela já olha.
Ela já sabe quem é a Lena, quem é a Pedra.
Foi quando eu nasci, nos anos 80, no tempo da abertura, em que nossa família saía da clandestinidade e parecia entrar no comercial americano dos anos 50. E você começa a dançar. 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 Thank you. Minha mãe me disse que desde os 4 anos você sabia que queria ser atriz. E parece que você sempre dava um jeito de me pôr pra contracenar com você.
Ok, that was the first excerpt from Elena. And before going to that, I would love to ask Petra if she could expand a little bit on her first steps into the academic world. She just said that authors such as Benjamin, Freud, and so on opened up her world. And I would really like her to dig a bit into how that happened, that from a strictly academic background, this desire to deal with cinema came into being.
Mm-hmm. Yes, one thing that I found frustrating in academia, I went on to do a master's in social psychology and applied and got into a doctorate in medical anthropology, was the idea that I would always have to be making thesis out of the experiences I investigated. I thought a thesis was so limiting of actually to live an entire experience, investigate a subject matter deeply, to then extract a thesis felt really reductive. And there was something, there's a tendency in anthropology itself to become more of towards literature than the more social scientific expression, a rejection of the scientific desire in a way. And in theater and in dance and in cinema, I felt I could express more of what I extracted from experience, a bit what Pina Bausch says so beautifully. I'm not interested in how people move, but what moves people.
Mm-hmm.
And I felt I could get closer to that, to what moves people, in expressing that artistically rather than academically. Of course, it's very possible, and many academics have done it masterfully in academia. But I kept being pulled towards the arts. And there was this story of Elena that haunted me throughout many years. I first had the desire of telling it when I was 19 and had a mission in a theater group that I was working with of creating a scene about the Book of Life. And I started thinking, what could be the Book of Life? Should I go to the Bible, the Quran, capital? And I decided to go to my diaries and gathered all my diaries, and in the midst of them found a diary of Elena that I had never seen. And it was a very uncanny experience because we had a similar handwriting. The experience were the same. The anxieties were the same. The fears were the same. And the parents were the same. So it was really like finding a writing that I had not done but was mine. When I read Freud's essay on the uncanny, it was very much what I'd felt at that moment and what I had been feeling for a while and kept feeling until I grew older than Elena. It was a feeling that I would follow her footsteps and she was my double and I had no control over my own destiny. And it was also an enchantment with the Ophelia complex, which I call.
Which is referenced in your film at the very end.
Yes.
In a way.
Very much. That image, I think, was the germinating pregnant image that created the film. This image of women floating in the water. When I first started dreaming of the film, I only knew I had that image. The rest came to fill that image from the sides, because I think it's what I wanted to tell was encapsulated in that image. And And it's something that I saw in my mother and myself and in my sister and many friends around me, young women that in, and also young men in certain cases, that in the coming of age drown in their own emotions and do not find a way to express them or permission to take them out of your body and into the world. And I felt it was an underrepresented problem. Even in Hamlet, it's underrepresented. Ophelia's there on the side. Most interpretations of Ophelia really don't capture her complexity. So I wanted to put Ophelia as the protagonist of the story, and that's what made me really want to do Elena.
And going back to the diary you were talking about, like finding the diary of Elena, there is also this kind of stream of consciousness that we can feel through the film, and that we can approach through the first excerpt that we've seen, with you dealing with very personal issues and mixing it with political issues in Brazil as well. Can you explain a little bit this form that you put through words and images?
Mm-hmm. In literature, I really am fascinated by stream of consciousness, by the work of Joyce, Virginia Woolf, and others. And I wanted to find a way to mix essay filmmaking into stream of consciousness in cinema, and also this investigation into the past. It's very much an archaeological film where I am exploring many, many layers of memory. And I went through a deep investigation to gather everything I could of Elena. I interviewed everyone who knew her, and each of these people would then give me a videotape, a cassette, traces that Elena had left. And I then immersed myself in these traces, and it was a very kind of alchemic experience, because I really, after 2 weeks immersed in this, I felt I was transported myself into a tunnel of time and met Elena for the first time as an adult myself, and she really came back to life in a very powerful way, and I felt for the first time the anger of losing her, something people often asked me if I'd never felt anger. I had not. I was seven. I didn't understand the complexity of what had happened. And so I could feel her death again and her life again, and therefore like really relive the grief of her loss. And she started appearing in dreams for me. And for the first year that I was editing the film with Didi Lacreta, a masterful editor here from Brazil, and writing with Carolina Zischinge, I was recurrently being visited by Elena, and really she was writing the film with me in a certain way.
You mentioned James Joyce and Virginia Woolf. I mean, in Joyce's most famous book, The Ulysses, basically there's the story of a man that moves around in a circle and explores all the different possible layers that have come before him in this place. So he forgets the keys to his home and doesn't get back to it, but his mind goes back and forth and experiences the different layers of history, of language, and so on. And you mentioned also Virginia Woolf, which obviously makes total sense, because when you said Woolf, I was thinking of The Waves, her mm-hmm. one of her most interesting books. And your film, even Elena, all your film have this wave structure in it, and this presence of multiple voices that tell multiple stories. So, mm-hmm. I mean, this has become one of the trademarks of your formal exploration of how you tell stories. But I would really love to ask you, what was the first thing that attracted you to writers such as Joyce or Virginia Woolf?
it's as if the human consciousness was a spider web, and most people try to express it as a straight line, and they managed to capture the spider web. So I think they're the most faithful authors in terms of capturing the human consciousness. And in cinema, I think Chris Marker, Agnès Varda, Alain René, together with Marguerite Duras, through their explorations in essay filmmaking and all they did in the Rive Gauche cinema wave, brought that to cinema, those investigations into memory and time. And I was very inspired by them. I think, as they say, there's a tendency in Latin American cinema to be very close to Don Quixote, to be very much exterior, impulsive, and very much focused on the exterior world and lacking sometimes subjectivity and self-reflection. And I think I was attracted towards that, like how can we get into a more subjective, self-reflective space in cinema?
And talking about this more self-respective, reflective place and the waves you were talking about before, Jonah, maybe we can watch the excerpt number 2, which is the end of the at the end of the film of Elena, where you're also mentioning Ophelia, by the way.
E eu, com muito mais consciência para sentir sua morte dessa vez. Imenso prazer que vem acompanhado da dor. Me afogo em você, em Ofélia. Nossa morte para encontrar ar. Para poder viver.
I turn to
pouco a pouco. As dores viram água. Viram memória.
So in this excerpt, you are filming bodies and sensations that are very important throughout your whole work, and it was already the case in your short film Undertow Eyes from 2009, in which you film your grandparents' relationship. And so here, as you said before already, you film your sister, your mother, and yourself, trying also to cope with one's identity and one's grief. And it feels as if you're really digging into your own feelings, your own affections, freezing the emotions. You have this very nice term that you said you're creating an archaeology of affections. Can you maybe explain a little bit more how you managed to create that and how you came to this freezing of feelings, of sensation through images and words, obviously?
Yes, I think the idea of really trying to dig into all the layers of memory. So I would sit weeks after weeks, and I had about six memories I had of Elena that were very clear in my mind. She was seven when I died. When I was seven when she died, so there were not very many memories, but I kept revisiting those memories and rewriting them and rewriting them and rewriting them. And each time new layers of that memory would come to the surface, and they were interconnect. And I think Tarkovsky said that he thinks that in his films, he tried to be as faithful as possible to his own memories, because he thought through that, he was certain that through that, the audience would feel their own memories of their childhood. And I think that childhood memories have a pregnant potential, where they become this other country that you revisit, that has its own rules and laws, and is very pregnant with all the meanings of life that you would, that have, will have ripple effects. I think my mission was just to be as faithful as I could be in this archaeological endeavor. And also there's the question of trauma. I think all my films are somehow about trauma, and trauma as a vortex, a black hole, a scar that erases all the meaning around the traumatic event, that makes you unable to signify it. And there, all you can do is repeat it. I, for many years, felt that in relation to what had happened to Elena. I didn't feel when I made the film. I think I was able to make the film because I had healed that trauma. But it was still the richest experience I had gone through in my lifetime, because traumas are that. They concentrate, as a black hole, they concentrate the energy of all that is around them. So when you deal with a trauma, and I think it's always helpful to deal with it going through the borders, not at the center, or else you're sucked by it, but going through the borders, it has so much strength in it. so much creative potential that it starts speaking by itself. And the same is true for The Edge of Democracy that we will speak about later, but and also for Amol and the Seagull in a different way. But I think trauma is a very helpful guideline for me because it is this black hole potential from which a lot of meaning springs up after you manage to get into it.
In the extract that we just saw, you say something very powerful, something that's very powerful. Pain turns into water. How did this idea came to you of something that becomes a feeling that's haunting you, that becomes a physical element? Pain turns into water.
A book that accompanied me a lot in the making of this film is Water and Dreams by Bachelard. And there he analyzes water in all its elements, the relationship between water and death, water and emotions. And Ophelia, he talks a lot about Ophelia. And I think that the process of massaging pain, I think pain and trauma are these knots that freeze us into a position where we are unable to make meaning and therefore are unable to move, and to be able to massage it and approach it and decode it until it becomes fluid.
And also this feeling of trauma that you were talking about is approached through your own approach of the archive, as we've seen in the excerpts. There you have you show a lot of family archive. You're very generous with that, and you also show some political archive. If we speak about Elena still. Can you explain a little bit the role of this archival material when you are preparing the film and with regard to this idea of trauma as well?
Well, that's when the film really becomes a collaboration between me and those who made those archives, right? They are the authors there. And in the case of these films, I mean, there are archives of my grandmother who was very ahead of her time and had a camera in the 40s and 50s, a Bell and Howell, and Elena, who then, when I was born, got a camera as a present and filmed immensely, and thanks to them, I could travel into those times, and it's interesting, this camera that is transmitted from woman to woman in the family. It's quite beautiful, this inheritance, and they were all forgotten, as videos tend to be. I think it's so much easier to manipulate photos, but videos, until you don't have an archaeologist in the family, they get forgotten, and no one had seen those Super 8s or those 16 millimeters or those VHSs, and they were really rotting and getting destroyed until I was lucky enough to find them and hear them and create through them.
Before we move on to your next film, Olmo and the Seagull, I would really love to ask you a very simple question. What was the film, or maybe a number of films, that really told you, that made understand you, that cinema was the thing that you wanted to do? I mean, was there a film that stayed with you for a long time, a filmmaker? What was the thing that made you fall in love on a very primal level with cinema?
Mm-hmm. I loved cinema from a very young age, but there was a class I did at Barnard College with Mary Reagan. It was the only film class I ever did, but she showed many films that mobilized me deeply and troubled me deeply and made me really fall in love with cinema as a way of storytelling. One was Beau Travail by Claire Denis, who was there yesterday. And the way she films bodies and the way that her look as a woman is expressed through every frame and how she brings movement into every frame. Every frame has a kind of a spiraling effect. And La Jetée by Chris Marker, The Battle of Algiers. I think those three were the most troubling films for me because they did what I did not know cinema was able to do.
Okay. I really wanted to ask you that because sometimes you miss what makes the heart of a director beat emotion and so on, because we tend to intellectualize, we speak a lot, but then it's interesting to know what are the real primal feelings about your relation to cinema and so on. And moving to Olmo and the Seagull, how did that happen? I mean, how did you meet Olivia, the company? How did it happen that you were in Paris? And I would especially like to ask you, how did you convince them to allow you in their private space?
Mm-hmm. It was a mixture of many events. When I was finishing Elena, the Théâtre du Soleil, which was a theater company that I had accompanied for many years, was in Brazil, and a friend of mine, Marta Kiss Pejoni, who is a theater director and has worked with me in most of my films. She had worked with the Théâtre du Soleil for 1 year, so she knew all of them and invited me to meet them. And I was finishing Elena, so I showed and invited Olivia and Serge to see Elena. And after she saw it, Olivia said, "Oh, we have to work together." And that stayed in the back of my mind. And I was then invited to do Docs Lab at CPH Docs, where they invite 10 European filmmakers to co-direct with 10 non-European filmmakers. And I was paired with Lea Glob, the Danish director. And we had 1 week to decide what we would make a film about. I, at the time, wanted to make an adaptation of Mrs. Dalloway by Virginia Woolf, One Day in the Life of a Woman. And Lea said, "Why don't we choose a real woman?" And I said, "Yes, great. Why don't we choose Olivia? Because she's an actress. She will be willing to go to spaces that and places that people would not, a normal person would not necessarily go." We invited Olivia. And Olivia said, "Yes, but I'm pregnant." So what was 1 day became 9 months. And the idea of dilating Mrs. Dalloway into the journey of this pregnancy. And it was interesting because for many reasons. But one thing, I was already wanting to do something more in the realm of fiction. But I had worked as assistant director in other fiction films, and I felt they were sometimes very constrained. And I really missed how I used to work in theater through workshops, improvisation, and really like a troupe, not with all the hierarchical divisions of cinema and kind of factory-like, but really like bring into cinema the spirit of a theater group, a theater troupe. And it was wonderful because we managed to do that. Serge and Olivia were extremely generous. They opened their life and their creativity, and through the time that we worked together, we really were a theater group improvising and re-improvising until we reached the film.
So you were really like working together with them, and how much was written already, and how much was improvised. How did you concretely work with them in this apartment?
Mm-hmm. So it was sketched. There were about 20 pages, I think, of the scenes that were sketched that had like guidelines. And then we also had an element which was we wanted to explore Olivia's stream of consciousness. So we asked her throughout the pregnancy to keep an audio diary. And that audio diary was then the element through which, with Tina Baz, the editor, and before Marina Melianji, we created the script for the voiceover, the script of Olivia's psyche, and also inspired some scenes. But most of the scenes were some I had through conversations with Olivia and Serge, I had written. Others were really inspired in the book itself, and others in the combination and the conflict of both, right? Because the pregnancy became somehow this rite of passage, and it's interesting because Chekhov is the play that is the undercurrent of the film, the Seagull, and it's interesting because Nina, Chekhov wrote Nina as inspired in Ophelia, and he imagined Nina as an Ophelia that survives, that is attracted by water as like a seagull, but she doesn't drown in it, but manages to fly over it, and that was really the underlying theme of the film, the idea that it's a woman that will manage to survive her Ophelia complex and enter into the next rite of passage in life, which can be motherhood or not, but deciding and professional decadence or survival, and all the challenges that come with maturing.
Yeah, and you have this very sensitive way of filming femininity and body and women's body that we already saw in Under Two Eyes, by the way, and in Elena, and then in Olmo and the Seagull as well, where you're really very close to this idea of what it feels to be pregnant and to change suddenly your body and your whole life, basically.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if you can explain a little bit more how you can be so close to women's bodies and to this femininity.
I don't know. I think I'm very interested by the body and by intimacy and trying to get close, kind of in an epidemic level, to the other body, and in trying as much as I can to, there's a desire in making films for me that really is of putting the spectator inside someone else's body. And so inside the body of Elena, inside the body of this pregnant woman, inside the body of Dilma, of Lula, of Bolsonaro. I mean, really, I think cinema has this power of transporting us into someone else's body, and that is very attractive for me.
But now we are going to see the way how you transport yourself and your camera into the lives/bodies of other people. And we are showing an extract from Olmo, which I think also explains something about how you work with cinema. We can go with extract number 3.
Coucou. Ça va? C'est une bonne journée?
Ouais.
Você tem. Vous avez fait quoi?
On a avancé dans les. Dans les scènes.
Lesquelles?
Le départ de. Le départ de Trigorine et Arkadina. On n'a pas payé le DF, je comprends pas.
Et qui essayait? Qui essayait Arkadina?
Là, c'était Camilla.
Et c'était bien Camille?
Oui, c'était bien. C'est pas mal du tout, d'ailleurs. Elle est bien, hein, Camille, hein, de toute façon. Elle a cette espèce de chose instinctif qui est incroyable, je trouve. On a bien rigolé, en tout cas. Il y a eu des moments vraiment... Elle était très drôle. C'est bien qu'elle soit un peu comme ça aussi, Arkadina.
C'est mieux?
Non, c'est pas mieux. C'est pas une question que ça soit mieux, Olivia, mais c'est...
C'est mieux, quoi. On te pose des questions? Sur moi, je veux dire.
Est-ce que je peux prendre ma douche?
Ça est-ce va? Que tu peux me répondre?
Mais Olivia, je suis pas encore très...
Mon Serge, il faut que tu comprennes quand même un peu. Hein.
Je viens à peine de finir une journée. Je peux pas être... J'ai mon présent, t'as ton présent, j'arrive...
Voilà. Attends, stop. Parce que mon présent n'est pas mon présent est ton présent aussi, sauf que c'est moi qui le porte, donc c'est ton problème aussi.
J'ai pas envie que ça se fasse comme ça, Olivia.
Ça fait 4 mois que je suis là, coincée, comme ça, dans cette position. En faisant en fait quelque chose qui nous concerne, tous les deux. Je suis en train de travailler pour tous les deux. Mais j'ai l'impression vraiment de travailler toute seule.
Oh, putain.
Je suis persécutée par la peur. Je suis persécutée par...
Mais Olivia, arrête d'avoir peur. Plus tu vas avoir peur, plus ça risque de venir. C'est... Je sais pas.
Ah, ok, super. Donc en plus, je dois me sentir coupable d'avoir non, peur parce que si jamais j'ai trop peur, je vais perdre l'enfant.
Arrête, dès que je dis quelque chose, Olivia.
Oui, mais je te répète, choisis tes mots, bordel. Choisis tes mots. Mais.
Je peux pas me sentir coupable, Olivia, de travailler. C'est pas possible. Je gagne 1800 euros par mois, je travaille comme un damné. Combien tu gagnes? 20 euros par jour avec tes indemnités, c'est quoi, ma chérie? Qu'est-ce que tu veux qu'on fasse avec ça? Je suis obligé d'être de travailler. Je suis obligé d'être à moins 10 heures par jour. On a l'EDF à payer, on a un loyer de 1450 euros par mois, Olivia. Et quand il va y avoir le bébé, il va falloir bien qu'on y pense. Parce que toi, tu n'auras jamais un salaire, donc ça va encore perpétuer, ça ne va pas s'arrêter après la naissance. Tu ne vas pas regagner tout d'un coup un salaire.
Tu as fini ton discours, ton monologue du comptable?
C'est la réalité, Olivia.
Je connais
très bien. J'ai des factures.
Je connais très bien nos dépenses, Serge.
Mais je sais.
Tu te trompes, mais qu'est-ce que tu te trompes? Je te demande pas ça. Je te demande d'être avec moi le soir et regarder un film et discuter ensemble.
On le fait, ça, quand même. À chaque fois que je fais un pas, c'est pas le bon pas, parce que c'est pas ce que t'as envie que je fasse. On est fatigué, là, je crois.
Ah non, moi j'ai plein d'énergie, j'ai rien foutu de la journée, je suis pas fatiguée du tout.
Oui. C'est ça qui se passe. C'est très très bien. Mais je me demande... Je voudrais une variation. A variation where... Olivia is a bit less severe and opens herself a bit more. I really like what you're doing, but I just wanted to see if there's a way that we can get a bit more into what's
happening in your mind and in your body while he's not here.
Yes, but he's not. Yes, but he. You listen what he answer.
Well,
c'est ma faute. Qu'est-ce que vous voulez que je.
Comment il peut.
C'est très énervant ce qu'il dit. Tu dois être un peu moins
con.
Moins con, parce que.
Qu'est-ce que tu lui as demandé, pardon?
Elle m'a demandé d'être un peu moins sévère. Ce que je veux bien. Ok, un peu plus victime. Un peu.
Mais moi, je peux aller la voir, donc jamais. Je reste encore à distance.
C'est un culé de première. Ok, bon, ok, let's do the version from the beginning.
No, it doesn't. Ah, ok. Because we can
try
okay.
So in this scene and in the film Olmo and the Seagull, it's very interesting because we are constantly also reminded of the role we play and the thin line between acting and being. So maybe can you comment a little bit on the scene we've just seen and your own position there in this setting?
Mm-hmm. Yes, I mean, I was very interested in a couple representing their own life, and what are the limits to that, and a couple of actors and an actress. And an actor who have in their lives the question of like, when are they acting? When does the acting stop? Right? Mm. And in this discussion, it was also interesting because we were exploring the claustrophobia, quarantining moment of Olivia, where she was like us all today, locked inside her house. For months on end, hostage of her own baby, and in a situation of invisibility, right? Her work was an invisible work, the work of creating a human being, and while Serge was the man playing the bills and flirting around and. And so it's exploring a side of pregnancy that is never very seldomly explored. How pregnancy creates, all the misconceptions of the conception, and how to do that, mixing fiction and reality. How to do it, exploring the boundaries, and also provoking the couple to go to the places where they would not necessarily want to go. When we were working, I was very much kind of the provocateur, and Leah was very much the very precise observational filmmaker. So there's another scene in the film where there's a fight between them and with flowers, and Leah managed to provoke that fight invisibly, while here I intervene in the scene to provoke them into another place, and that was the game that we proposed ourselves to do.
And how did you edit all this different thing? Because the film has a very precise structure, but it's also multi-layered. So because you have the real story of the pregnancy, the real story of the couple relationship, but you have also them playing themselves. So how did you weave all those different elements together when you were editing the film?
Well, first we worked with Marina Melienge, who's a Brazilian director and editor, very talented, and we kind of built the structure of the film, the baseline of all the scenes. And then with Tina Baz, who is a French-Lebanese editor, we worked for a few months really through with the element of the voiceover that changed and created the necessity for other scenes in the middle. And we even filmed a few scenes afterwards. So the editing was where the writing of the film took place. There was writing prior, but the bulk of the writing happened. So the editors are really co-writers with us in this film. And yeah, through the editing, we would understand the dramaturgy of it and what was missing and what worked and how to orchestrate these three layers, as you mentioned.
And do you feel this this way of working allows you a lot of freedom, or is it more constraining? On the contrary, can you say a little bit more about the way you see this hybrid cinema, this hybridicity that you have in your films that we saw in Elena, that we see again in Olmo?
I think, well, for me, it's oxygen, because the films are, as they say, I'm a materialist. What I film dictates the film that I will tell. I mean, by this hybridism and this being writing in the edit room, I do not allow myself to be entrapped by my ideas. I allow reality to be constantly surprising me. There are master filmmakers that manage to write all that complexity in the script before and then execute it. But there are also many mediocre filmmakers that become entrapped by their own scripts and do not allow for the actors to oxygenate, to give oxygen to their script. And that is really what I wanted to avoid at all costs, and allow for the film to be really a product of a theater group in a way. It was really that exercise. How possible is that? And of course, Cassavetes did that. Peter Brook did that. And in this film, they were really inspirations. Like, the work of Peter Brook with Marat Saad and U.S. and of Cassavetes with Opening Night and Husbands and da 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 were, I think, the main inspirations for this film, together with Rosemary's Baby.
Oh yes, expand a bit on that.
Because I think Rosemary's Baby is the only film I have seen, and probably there are others, but I have not seen that. Explores the complexity of pregnancy.
Okay.
Of how a woman loses control over her own body when she becomes pregnant. It becomes the body of society, right? To the extent that abortion is still forbidden in Brazil. So a woman can go to jail if she does something to her own body. And so you really lose control. And Rosemary's Baby shows that in the most diabolical way.
And since you mentioned society, we are moving on to your next film, which is a film that has also been nominated for the Academy Awards, which is The Edge of Democracy. But before we move into that, I would like you to try to frame for us the discourse that's been going on in Brazil, because maybe people think that this is something recent about, but Brazil has had a history of, and filmmakers also already in the past, filmmakers from the Cinema Novo era, but also from the Cinema Marginal, always dealt with the complexities of Brazil's past, be it colonial, be it slavery, and so on. So I would like if you would talk a bit about all these elements that I mentioned so quickly, how that seeped into your consciousness as a filmmaker, mm-hmm. history not only of your country, but how artists, filmmakers, writers, poets worked with that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yes, it's a Brazil is a country made by coups. We had many coups, no revolutions, and every rebellion was brutally crushed. And it's a bit like the leopard, like let's change things so everything can stay the same. Let's do the revolution before they do it. The elite is constantly advancing itself in doing coups before revolutions can ever take place, and that's the case since the independence until the coup in 1964 and more recently the impeachment of Dilma. And Glauber Rocha's film in Transed Earth, Terra em Transe, shows that very well. It was funny because at one moment when I was editing The Edge of Democracy with David Barker, who was one of our editors and co-writers, we were like, oh my God, we should use Entranced Earth as opening of the chapters of our film because everything is contained there. It's a film Glauber did I think, in 66. And it's all we lived in the past years seemed to already be contained in that film. It's amazing how prophetic he was. He shows, there's a scene which shows a man speaking to the owner of a television, and he says, basically, like, oh, what are we going to do with Rivera? I think Rivera. And he says, oh, we're going to make a coup so that he cannot win the election. We'll make a coup. Oh, and how will we deal with the people? Oh, there's the television, and we'll put advertisements, and then he says the name of this fictional U.S. company that will buy for the advertisements. So the U.S. money will pay for the coup through the television money. So it's all contained there. It's really where we live the constant curse of being a colony. And when it felt more, when we start to overcome our colonial situation, the coups come to reinforce us to go back to our subjugation.
Before we move on to the next question for Petra Costa, I would like to remind the audience that they can submit their questions and we will be asking them to Petra shortly. So this first excerpt that we saw from The Edge of Democracy, which was nominated for an Academy Award, has your mother meeting Dilma Rousseff, who was ousted by the bureaucratic coup that was hosted, organized by Cunha, Temer, and the likes. And your mother and Dilma basically are more or less from the same generation. They were on the same side, and somehow they met there in your film for the first time. I mean, emotionally, because the political implications are quite obvious, but how hard was it emotionally to organize that meeting when Brazil as the society refused once again to face its history and went back to the old ways? I mean, in that meeting of Dilma and your mother is a kind of utopia coming realizing itself at the darkest moment of Brazilian recent history. So how did you live that?
It took a very long time to manage to get access to Dilma. When we started making the film in March 2016, I wrote a letter to her and to Lula and to Aesio, the other main character, asking for interviews, and Temer. Letters they never read. And so I went into Congress to film the impeachment proceedings there, and everyone with our team, our amazing director of photography, Jean Atala, whom I'm never be able to make this film. And when everyone we would meet there, we would ask, do you know Dilma, Lula, Aesio, Temer? Could you help us get contact? And everyone was like, it's impossible. The country is living the most tragic moment in its history, or tense moment in its history. Like, they won't have time for you. But we kept trying and trying, and it was never possible. And months went by until I managed to sneak in a bus full of historians that were going to visit Dilma in the presidential palace. She was already distant from office, living in the presidential palace. And there I met her for the first time, introduced myself, gave her a DVD of Elena, and said, look, I've been here for months trying to interview you. Can you please, filming the ostriches here in your garden, because I can't film anything else, can you please allow me to interview you? And she said yes, but a few days or weeks later, she gave us a very formal interview with only her armor and this rigid self that she would usually present to the public. And I was like, oh my God, I need to access this woman somehow beyond this place, right? How do I enter into her subjectivity? And then after she was impeached and she went back to the south of Brazil, I asked if I could visit her and if I could bring my mother, who she had not met, but she knew about because they had been in hiding at the same time in prison, in the same prison. When Dilma won, my mother made a list of 30 things they had in common. And it happened. I mean, in that moment of that encounter, Dilma says something she never told anyone else. She said that she never wanted to become president. And what bigger revelation could one expect from her?
There is a question that arrived right when you were talking, and I think this question is quite relevant or pertains a lot to what we were just saying. And this question comes from Valeska Bittencourt Coelho, and she says, many critics in Brazil accuse the film of being Manichaean and containing untruths in the personal history of your family. How do you respond to that?
I think those are very sometimes sexist remarks and other times cynical, I believe, because, and other times they just lack information. For example, one of the criticisms said that my parents weren't actually in hiding because they visited my grandfather, my grandparents, once a year. Yes, they visited them once a year. My grandparents didn't know where my parents lived. They lived in the south of Brazil. My grandmother thought she lived in Goiás, in the center of Brazil. And we're working with, as I say in the film, my mother teaching literacy to students and wives of workers, and my father working as a pharmaceutical company seller from door to door while they were trying to plot the revolution. The difference is that they weren't in, the revolution in Brazil did not happen. There was the Guerrilha da Araguaia that they almost went to. They didn't go because my mother was pregnant of Helena. And then they were basically in standby for many years. And then when Pedro Pomar, the mentor of my parents, was killed, they became for some time kind of an orphan cell where there was no one instructing them what to do. and they were waiting and waiting until the opening of democracy happened, and then they tried to do it through the democratic path. But my mother worked as security guard for Pedro, and his death impacted her very much. They were going to live together in Pará, the north of the country, when he was killed. And it seems a very lack of empathy to question their position without really knowing in depth what they went through.
No, I had to ask you this question because obviously there have been many polarized reactions.
Yes.
To film, to say the least. And
but it could only be so because what happened in Brazil was so polarizing. I mean, they had to build a wall in front of the Congress. Any film about this, what happened in Brazil in the past 5 years, would be polarizing. So it's normal.
Can you tell us a little bit more about how long for you does the filming process take, and how long does it, I mean, especially for The Edge of Democracy, because you gathered a lot of material and it took you a long time, obviously, to film everything. Can you explain a little bit how you work with this material?
Yes. Well, this film was quite unique because we thought at first it would be only about the impeachment. So we had decided that we would film the impeachment process and it would at most take a year. So we filmed that year intensely, and we filmed the entire impeachment trial. That was the most time-consuming because it was hours and hours of hearing and testimonials and accusation and defense. And once we started editing that the next year, in 2017, we had to work with multiple editors to be able to do it in less time. And each editor was responsible for a chunk of period of time and reducing that period of time. And as soon as we started to take control and make sense of what had happened, a new event would happen and Temer would almost be impeached. So we had to go back to Brasilia with João Atala and our producer, Thiago Pavão, and film more and then make sense of that again, and then another event would happen, and then Lula started to be imprisoned, and then as soon as we felt okay, we have more or less a film here, we'll start here and end with Lula's prison, then Bolsonaro was elected. So reality was constantly challenging the film to reimagine itself.
When did you decide to pull the plug? I mean, when did you decide that you had eventually stopped filming?
Well, as soon as it became clear that the film would not be Dilma's impeachment, that the story was still unfolding, I had to imagine, okay, so when does this end? And already I said, okay, I think it can only end in the next election, because that's when this chapter will finish. So I already knew that I wanted to go until the election of the next president.
One of those incredible cinematic moments where the whole history of a country is also the story of a specific family, but it's also an incredibly vivid comment of the situation we all live and experience politically at the moment. And it's also a scene that it's edited and directed in an extremely precise way. And the question is, how did this scene come to you, and how long did it take for it to be so effective? Because this is really an idea put into images that become another idea, which is quite unique and goes way beyond of what we call today the realm of documentary.
When I saw that wall being built, was one of the few moments where the voiceover immediately came to my head. I was still in the filming process. Most of the voiceover was written after, but right there, and then I started. That voiceover came to me, and because it deals with something that I was already investigating, which is the division inside my own family and how much of the contradictions of Brazil I could find inside my own family. For me, it was very revealing that in 1964, when the president at the time, Jango, said that he was going to do agrarian reform by expropriating 1 kilometer of land next to the roads, my family, my grandparents and great-grandparents at the time became desperate, thinking that they would lose their farms because their farms were right on the side of the road. And my mother was there 14 years old, as a testimony to that moment where she saw her parents and grandparents desperate and backing the coup, saying, oh my God, they wanted to fly immediately out of Brazil in fear that the country would become communist. And to their relief, the military coup took over. It's a bit what I explain in this scene. For me, that scene that I imagine encompasses so much of the contradictions of Brazil and the curse of Brazil, that you could have an elite that decides the destiny of the country repeatedly over time and prevents the country from becoming not a socialist country, but a capitalist country, because the United States had the Homestead Act after the Civil War, where the land that was not occupied was decided that would become the land of the person who occupied the land. That never happened in Brazil. Brazil, after the abolition of slavery, and we were the last country to abolish slavery, decided that the land that was not occupied would belong to the state. That's one of the reasons why, until today, there's a mass of people in Brazil that never were able to enter the lower middle class or the middle class because they were never able to have access to the land. And that contradiction is inside my own family. And when I saw that wall, I saw that contradiction exposed. And I saw how actually accidental it was for me to be identified with the left side of the wall. I had everything to be on the right side of the wall. It was this mutation unexpected that happened in 64 when my father was in New York that misplaced me on the wrong side of the wall of where I should have been from my inheritance.
So for you, the fact that you include again your family in this more political story this time, was it something that you knew from the beginning, or was it something that arrived at some point while you were filming? Did you? How did this really?
No, I didn't know. I was actually writing that scene for a fictional piece that I was writing. So I had that scene in mind for other reasons. And then coincidentally, everything happened. I was very inspired in The Battle of Chile by Patricio Guzmán, which was a film I watched early on in the 2000s and didn't really understand. And then watched again in the end of 2015 and through it understood what was happening in Brazil and saw how much of it was just a repetition. And I tried at first with Jordana Berg, who was the editor with whom we began this journey, to edit this in the more and to write a voiceover that would be more objective. Because voiceovers was unfortunately necessary, because how it was so much background that was needed for one to enter into the drama that I was filming. Yeah. And so I tried to do a more objective narration, thought of inviting someone else to narrate more objectively, but it felt very alien to me. And so I started writing a more subjective narration, and which I had already written during the process of filming, but as it is for me every time with a subjective narration, it's something I become very insecure about, and you constantly self-sabotaging yourself not to use it. And Jordan actually sneaked it in to the edit after she read it.
It's incredible. The questions are just flooding in, and there is obviously a question that relates to the political situation in Brazil. It's unavoidable. We knew it would happen, and the question is: the democracy is increasingly in edge with Bolsonaro. Brazil is going through an increasingly authoritarian and fascist wave, and the left wing does not react. In your opinion, why is the Brazilian left wing almost dead?
The left in the world is very lost for a long time. And it's unfortunate because at the same time, this is a moment where things are becoming clear. It's becoming clear that you need a welfare state, that you need public health, that the masks of the ultra-right and far and the ones who want a minimal state is falling off, and what you're seeing is the desire for death, the total lack of human empathy and the fascistic desire for the death of the other. And so it's a great opportunity for the left to create it and regain a narrative space, but it's not managing to do so. The left in Brazil is very lost since 2002. I think it's been continuously losing itself. It built itself and got stronger and stronger from the 80s until the moment that Lula was elected, and there was a huge potential. You see it in Lula's speech when he wins, and since then Lula's speech became less and less strong and more pragmatic, less oniric, anthropophagic, modernist, and also and the other currents of the left have not managed to have enough strength. But there are strong people. There are voices, potent voices that we hear, like Boulos, who's the leader of the houseless movement in Brazil, and he's been very active in the public opinion, and he ran for president. Manuela Dávila and many candidates of PSOL. They're dispersed, they're fragmented, and they're not taking advantage of this moment as they could.
There is another question that relates to what you were just saying, and it's basically about how do you manage or not to be impartial in not taking sides?
Impossible. It's impossible to be impartial. But what the exercise that I constantly tried to do with this film was to look at the facts. And I was ready when I got into the Congress to be convinced that Dilma should be impeached and that Lula should be in prison, even though my instinct told me that there was something very strange about all that. I was really ready to be convinced, and I heard all the arguments, and repeatedly Congress people would say to me that her impeachment was constitutional, and it was confusing many times. And it was not until I read How Democracies Die by Stephen Levitsky that it became clear that that is no excuse, that any impeachment is constitutional because the impeachment law is very vague. So anyone can be impeached as soon as you have a majority in Congress. But what sustains the health of a democracy and the survival of democracy is not the constitution, which can be easily manipulated by two unwritten norms, which he calls forbearance, which is like self-control, and mutual respect, and which is the idea that a party that always has as the instruments to destroy the other party, but they won't do though because they will have forbearance and mutual respect. They will hold themselves of not destroying their opponents because they want the survival of democracy in the long term. And the problem is that both in the United States and in Brazil, in the United States, the Republican Party in Brazil, the PSDB, started to lose faith that they would win the next election because they were losing voters. With more people of color, more women voting, they were losing voters. So they tried to do it through undemocratic means.
Mm. And there is also another question, which is regarding the your research process by someone who asks whether which books or works have been helpful to think through how people and society face and forget their histories, basically, and whether you have any book to recommend on that specific topic, because obviously your films are also a means of keeping the memory of history and of stories. At the same time, and also what does it mean in terms of your research process?
Mm-hmm. Well, Walter Benjamin, I think, is the best writer about memory ever, and he says that everything that is not used by the present as its own is threatened to be lost irretrievably. And that was an inspiration for me in every film. I think every film I've done is an attempt to preserve memory. And in terms of democracy, I think David Runciman, How Democracies End, as well as Levitsky and Zibla, How Democracies Die, books that explore what happened during fascism and Nazism, I think they're more relevant than ever. And understanding how that mechanism works. And I think there are many interesting things as well about the repetition of history that can be found in Marx, of course. And Gilberto Freire, even though he made so many horrible remarks, his book, Casa Grande Senzala, I think is very powerful rendition of the slave inheritance in Brazil, and also one that is much less known, Nathaniel Leff, who is an American who studied Brazil in the 60s, that it's through his book that I took out this statistic that more slaves died in Brazil than were born. And he compares the development of Brazil to the United States, and he says that, different from most interpretations, the reason he thinks Brazil did not develop as the United States, because both countries were equally developed in the 18th century, was the way Brazil dealt with the legacy of slavery in the 19th century, how it did not let the freed slaves have access to the land. That is a very new thought, and new old thought. He wrote it in the 60s, but it hasn't really been digested by the Brazilian intellectual society. Which prefers to blame the Portuguese for its curses than to look at its own elite.
We have, since we have the students from the head in Geneva, we have a very interesting question for you that says, what made you decide against going to film school?
I didn't decide. I still have a desire to go to film school. Okay. I never allowed myself.
And there's another question that Matteo asked, which strategies can a filmmaker set up to go from an individual desire, a portrait, a family story, which is, of course, strong and interesting because it's personal, to a universal matter and also interest an audience, how to make the personal universal. Mm-hmm. How do you deal with that?
I think when you approach the personal looking for what is most uncomfortable about it, what is most shameful, traumatic, painful, what you least want to share with others is what is most interesting to share, usually, is what is most, where most of the potential is, where most of the energy is concentrated, wanting to, at least I think. And also the question of intimacy, right? To more than actually going into what is taboo, is going deep, I think, going as deep as one can.
And there is another question about going back to the edge of democracy. The person is wondering whether there is edge of democracy too on the way, and because many people have been asking for a second the edge of democracy, especially now with what's going on in Brazil. So the person wants to know whether there is something on its way.
Well, it's a question that is haunting me too. I don't have an answer for it yet. But we're doing a project called Dystopia, where we are collecting people's narratives and own perspectives of their quarantine, of the pandemic across the world. And I would like to invite anyone who wants to share their images with us. We will pay for the images we will use in the film. And we would love to compose this mosaic through everyone's, through as much as possible, through as much points of view as possible. So I would love, and if you can send it to Dystopia, Dystopia, at Buscavida Filmes, films, but with an E, .com.
We will transmit this message later on also on our website. So for those of you who haven't picked it up, we will put the correct address and you can send your images to Petra's production company. There is a subject that we haven't touched upon yet, and it's from a member of the audience, and the question goes, can you speak about your role and work as a producer? Because this person has seen recently the film about Hector Babenco, which won a Golden Lion in Venice, by the way. And what changes from being a director on going to be a producer?
Well, that I can't take credit for that film. That's really the work of Barbara Paz, who is an amazing actress and now filmmaker. And I had the luck to meet her a few years ago, and it was for it, our relationship in this film was more of provocation, where she would come with me, to me since the beginning of wanting to do it, insecure of how much she should put her point of view. She was the wife of Hector and Babenco, and was filming him throughout his last years of life, where he was battling with the cancer. And I think there was a pressure for her to do an objective portrayal of this master of cinema. And I was more like provoking and trying to help her to dare to film her dreams and her nightmares. And she did that wonderfully. I told her to watch The Beaches of Agnès Varda, which I think is a film that is great for anyone who is feeling locked or uninspired, because Agnès there manages and dares to do everything that comes to her mind. And that film inspired the, Barbara. And she managed to do a beautiful poem of love and death. But as a producer, I've also worked with Moira Passoni, whose film Ecstasy is playing at Vision du Réel. And it's a beautiful film that Moira, who's been a very great companion for the past years and worked with me in all my films, did about her own experience battling with anorexia for many years. And it was more of a collaboration where I would help her sometimes write, sometimes I would film with her, and she had an amazing team, Janice Davila as director of photography, and Daniela Capilato, and it is a film that manages to give a very different rendering of what one usually thinks of when one thinks of anorexia, and put you in the perspective of the anorexic, which gets anorexia not because of necessarily wanting to be pretty satisfy the desire of the other, but in a competition with her own self and as a form of pleasure and control.
But and as a producer, you and filmmaker, how do you work together with the filmmakers with whom you produce their film?
Well, the difference is that you're trying to help the other tell her story rather than you telling your story, and so it's trying to channel what the other really wants to say. And the main thing is, with these two films specifically, was battling their own insecurity and their own desire to self-sabotage, as they are very personal films. That's usually the case with me as well when I'm doing personal films. And trying to get at the heart of what they actually want to say and which they're not allowing themselves to say.
Mm.
And there's one simple question, I mean, simple quotation marks from Rodrigo. He says, I would like to know how anthropology changed your perception of Brazil.
I think anthropology was very rich in all the post-colonial debates and anti-colonial debates it renders, and how it really questioned itself as a discipline on how one has the right to portray the other, how a Westerner has the right to go and give a rendering of a community, and the layers of power that are imbued in that rendering, which sometimes says that it's just an objective rendering. And I think ethnography as an instrument help me try to learn from Brazil by going and seeing Brazil and hearing the people, and rather than creating theories about it, but really like a bottom-up desire to learn on the ground with the people and make your... And it's amazing, because if you see the scene for me that in Praça da Sé, which is a square, a very popular square in São Paulo, there, what they were dialoguing there in 2015, the men that usually live in that square, surpassed all the theoreticians that were trying to make political analysis of Brazil. You had all the contradictions there. And so what anthropology teaches one is that, how to become permeable and to the human.
Mm-hmm. And there is also another question in that sense of human living this situation is did you seek or experience catharsis with making The Edge of Democracy, or did you feel the need to make the film as a sense of responsibility?
I felt catharsis because everything that was happening was so painful, and filming it was a form of digesting it and making sense of it for me. I even had a sensation that in the beginning that there, it was as if what made me want to make this film was to really dive into the cancer of fascism, go deep into it and try to somehow make sense of it.
Right now there's a weird thing going on in Europe, because we are almost looking hopefully to the next coup in Brazil, hoping that Bolsonaro will be ousted. I mean, how weird is it if someone, I mean, I was talking to people about Bolsonaro, and this person told me, maybe there will be another coup, hopefully, and they will get rid of him. How weird must it be to you when people talking about the coups that are going on in Brazil, even if one would get rid of Bolsonaro? I mean, it's...
Well, I hope he will, if he gets out of power, that he will get out of power through democratic means. I hope it will not be. Yeah. I hope it won't be through a coup. And the coup that I fear most is the coup that he could do, or the military could do, that they're constantly threatening and trying to put in the underlining, in the between the lines of what they say. That is several situations. What they said: if the street starts to protest or to rebel, we will not think twice before we do the Institutional Act number 5, which was the most severe act of the dictatorship, that forbid public demonstrations, that installed censorship. But he, so much of what he is already doing is already destroying so much of our democracy. He's constantly putting the institution, like discrediting the institutions, discrediting the Supreme Court, discrediting Congress, discrediting the press, discrediting everyone who says anything against him. Like he is completely unable, and always was, to live and have dialogue in democracy. And what is scary is not him, is the amount of people that voted for him and continue to support him despite all that.
And how do you see the future of cinema in the next, of Brazilian cinema in the next day, with this civil war that Bolsonaro is waging against filmmakers and independent cinema? I mean, what happened to Kleber Mendoza Filho and so on? I mean, that could become unfortunately, the rule. So what do you see? I mean, I'm not asking you to predict the future, but it seems as if it's going to be tougher and tougher to make independent films that are critical about the status quo and so on.
Yes, it's a very hard time for Brazilian cinema. I think there are more than 400 projects that are waiting for that their money is frozen. And it's crazy because the cinema industry in Brazil mobilizes as much money as the pharmaceutical industry. So there's jobs that are created. And this war that he's waging against the cinema class is really detrimental, not just artistically, but for the economy. And now Brazilian filmmakers will depend more than ever on outside support, on financing their film through other ways outside of Brazil, private companies. And it will be horrible because it took so long for Brazilian cinema to recuperate the damage that was done during the coup in 64 and then by Collor in the 80s. It seems that every time our cinema starts to stand on its feet and walk, it's hit again and goes back to the ground. And I hope this won't happen this time, that it will manage to breathe through other means, because it's last year was one of the best years, or the best year of Brazilian cinema ever. We never had so many films in so many festivals and such a rich production.
It's interesting because talking about Brazilian cinema, there was a question also that asks, since the excerpt that we've seen of Helena, the first one where she criticizes the state of Brazilian cinema. So the question is, how much has Brazilian cinema changed from then to now, and how has it evolved?
Yes, when Helena gave that interview, Hector Babenco, I think, was the only person making a film in Brazil. Mm. There was one film per year. And then Walter Salles would make Foreign Land soon after, with many of Helena's friends, actually. And so it was a desert. And now there are 150 films produced per year, I think. Last time I looked at the statistics, it was 150. So it changed drastically. The 13 years of government where there was a lot of investment in cinema really changed the spectrum and proliferated the productions.
There is a question that's quite interesting, because I'm sure that many students are asking themselves the very same questions, and it says, how do you clarify your ideas in applications for fundings, since funders often want to have a precise plan? How much do you know before filming? Do you have a shot list, script, rough outline? How do you manage to get your projects funded?
It's a nightmare every time. I'm going through that nightmare right now, trying to write my next film for funding. Yes. Well, with each film, it's different. But you have to write what you know. And actually, with Helena, I had a fairly developed script, with Olmo as well. But with Olmo, I think we had to... Olmo was funded by the DFI, the Danish Film Institute, and we did it in co-production with Zentropa, a Danish production company. So it was a very different way of funding. But you basically, you have to write as much as possible. You have to fake it when you don't know it and imagine things that you will change afterwards. With The Edge of Democracy, we decided not to fund it through the Brazilian sphere because it was a film that was going to deal with so many politicians and presidents, and we funded it first through several funders in the US and the UK, like Doc Society, Tribeca, Sundance, and Cinerich, and Bertha Fund, and then as soon as we had a teaser, we showed it to Netflix, and Netflix became interested quite quickly in the film. So it's, each film was a different format, but for that, today you usually need a teaser. So it's kind of how do you film a teaser when you don't have money? I don't know. They want us to do magic.
But would you say, was it easier for The Edge of Democracy because the political side aspect of it was
much
strong?
Easier.
Yeah,
much easier. Yes, they want. Yeah, they always want famous people. That, so that was the only film where I had famous people. It was much easier to fund.
Tell us something before we go back to the questions from the audience. I mean, you hinted a bit how The Edge of Democracy was perceived and received, but I imagine that the debate was quite rough when they saw your film. I mean, but obviously I don't want to know about what happened, let's say, the reactions from the right side. I guess that you had also some issues with the left wing about your film, or was it, how did it go? How did, for instance, the left wing perceive your film?
It was interesting because the film had many waves of reactions. It had a wave of reaction in June 2019 when it came out on Netflix, then another wave of reaction when it was not shortlisted, then when it was nominated. So at first, the response, I think, was overwhelmingly positive. There was like one tweet per minute about the film for several months. And many people who would say, oh, that they hadn't been speaking to their best friends or to their fathers for years because of political disagreements, and that through the film they managed to have empathy for each other's point of view and speak again. That was very moving. And also people who said, I was so mistaken, I was so brainwashed. I voted for Bolsonaro, I was there protesting for Dilma's impeachment, and the film showed me how brainwashed I was. And in the left, I think there are very different responses. There were mostly, I think, positive responses. There were responses as well that said that the film was not radical enough. Some people that wanted me to put fire in Brasilia, to ask for the revolution, to others who thought the film did not have enough diversity in it, that I did not portray enough other communities, that I was too centered in the Congress. But that was really the premise of the film. We wanted to be in the halls of the palace, in the Shakespearean element, which I think was very rich in the film. That you have like five, six characters who are betraying each other and really involved in a Shakespearean or Greek tragedy. And then there were people who complained about my voice. There were people who, there were all types of criticisms. But I think for me, what really made me happy were these ideas of creating dialogue and people that were able to watch it. There are people that voted for Bolsonaro in my own family that thought the film was balanced, that and appreciated and identified with the film. And there's even a congressman from Bolsonaro's party who said he saw the film and showed it to his entire staff.
And talking about your the use of voiceover, There is someone who says that they really like the way you use the voiceover, for it's reflective and energizing at the same time, and it always pushes the story forward. Can you tell more about the process and how you approach the writing and the use of the voiceover at the same time and tone?
So that was very collaborative process. I was writing and rewriting the voiceover with the editors, who were Jordana Berg, Felipe Lacerda, David Barker, Karen Harley, and Joaquin Castro, and Tina Bass, many editors. And they were really writing with me much of this, and with my co-writers, David Barker, Moira Passoni, and Carol Pires. Carol was a journalist who lived the impeachment very closely. She was reporting it for Piauí, a Brazilian magazine. And Moira is the director of Ecstasy, who was a longtime collaborator. But we were basically writing and rewriting and rewriting. There were things I wrote in the filming process, and then that started as kind of the bare bone of the script. And then much of it was filling the gaps of what of the storyline. So we had to tell a story that more or less started in the 80s, in the beginning of Brazilian democracy, then goes until 2016, to have to go from the beginning, tell the story of Brazilian democracy. How do you tell the story of Brazilian democracy without being didactic, boring? That was the challenge. I think that was the biggest challenge, because then when we got into the events that we had filmed, it was much easier. We were dealing with vibrant flesh, but how to tell, encapsulate 20 years of story into a voiceover. That was really what we spent most time like writing and rewriting to find the balance for that.
We have another question, of course, from a certain Rafael Barbosa. And it says, in the credits you quote João Moreira Salles. I wanted to know how was your closeness to him, if you were close to João Moreira Salles.
So I met João when I did Helena. I sent him a DVD of Helena because I really loved his work in Santiago and Entre Atos and Notícias de uma Guerra Particular. And I really wanted his opinion while I was actually editing the film. And he gave me a very profound and detailed feedback, very generous. And from there on, he became a sort of mentor, and every film I've done, I've sent to him while I'm in the editing phase and asked for his feedback. And with this film, the same. I think he saw one or two cuts of it and gave me his feedback, which is always quite helpful.
There is another question.
Oh, in Helena, there's something funny because he showed the film to Eduardo Coutinho, who is a master documentary filmmaker from Brazil who died a few years ago. And Coutinho said, great, but just take out all the women, all the men from the film, because I still had some men in the film.
And so there is another question about the transdisciplinarity of the different art. And the person would like to know how far cinema is now developed into an art form in its own, separate from theater, literature, music. What do you think about this?
I think Bresson talks very well about this, no, when he says that there's many attempts in film to be just theater many attempts in film to be just theater. And when film is really filmic is when it manages to do something else other than theater. And Tarkovsky as well, and how the ability of the cinematic language to be poetic and to associate itself through the language more of dreams than the language of the rationale. And I agree with that. I think that there's a possibility of film language to approach dreams. I think no other artistic language can be as close to the language of dreams as cinema can. And maybe that is where the greatest potential of cinema is.
We have another question. This is a very straight one. And it goes, how is Lula today? What is his response to your film?
I don't know how is Lula today. I haven't been following, but I think he is quite in quarantine, as we all are. And I see he's been tweeting and challenging Bolsonaro. And he had a positive response to the film and spoke about it in interviews. And it's worth watching what he said.
And what did he say?
I think he said something about how he liked how he saw it in prison. He saw the film in prison more than once, and how he liked the personal perspective of it, which is something that I was happy to hear, because when you're making a film about such huge political events, I felt that the characters I was portraying would feel offended that I would speak about my family. Like, come on, you're co-opting the story of the country to speak about your family. And I was happy to see that it resonated.
And another question about your way of filmmaking and your way to engage yourself as a filmmaker. The person asks, what is your weakest aspect as a filmmaker?
My insecurity. I think I'm very insecure, constantly in self-doubt. And with this film, I had the luck of not having the doubt, which is the worst of doubts when you're making a film, which is, should I make this film? But there are certain films that until the end, you're having that doubt, should I make this film? And it can be quite anxiety producing. Because you're constantly asking, am I apt enough to make this film? But if you're also asking, should I make this film? Am I apt enough? Should I make it? Am I apt? Then it's a lot of self-doubt.
And is this the what is the part of your work that consumes most time in the same idea of the weaknesses of the filmmaking, like
so
in terms of mental or physical energy, or you know,
in all these films that we spoke about, editing, because they were all really written in the edit room and with the editors, thanks to the God blessed editors that worked with me. Without whom these films would not have been made.
We have a question from one of the producers that have a film in competition at Vision Durel, and this question comes from Kostas Tagalakis, is the producer of a wonderful short film called Bella, which I hope you will have a chance to see. And he simply wants to know how much did it take for the Edge of Democracy to be properly funded.
How long or how much?
How long?
Oh, how long?
How much in terms of time, and how long, of course, in terms of time?
A year and a half, but there were fundings that came since the beginning, like early on, and then fundings that came later on. So until the beginning to then were like a year and a half, which was possible then to film for as long as we filmed, because the funding allowed.
Mm-hmm. And since you mentioned your next project, Dystopia, which we remind our audience to remember to send you the images that they shot during this lockdown and quarantine. The question asks, Will dystopia make a close relation between coronavirus and politics? And then the second part of the question is, how do we explain that complex situation, which is a lot more than a disease problem? So, I mean, that the disease shows something that's not working in politics.
I think it's inextricably interrelated, no, what we're seeing, politics and the pandemic. So I think it will necessarily be related. And I think that what the pandemic shows is it exposes a lot of what was maybe not obvious to everyone, which is what I was saying a bit before, how much of this fascist rhetoric was hidden behind a rhetoric of hatred for the other, hatred for the left, hatred for the Workers' Party, hatred towards artists, hatred towards gays, hatred towards women. And what the coronavirus shows that it's actually hatred towards the human being, the humankind. It's a desire for death, a complete disrespect for life, which is very much in the fascist rhetoric. Why do they have skulls and their symbolism? Why do they have guns and their symbolism? Why was he elected with the symbol of the gun? Sometimes that is hidden because you think he's actually just killing the other. No, it's doesn't really care for human life in general. Yesterday he was asked about the more than 5,000 people who died, and he said, "So what?"
Yeah.
So it really throws into obscenity the fascistic nightmare we're living.
Yeah.
And can you maybe you already partly answered, but can you explain how you yourself in this context do you see your own work developing as a filmmaker, as a woman filmmaker in Brazil?
In the context of the pandemic or of
no, in today's political context in Brazil.
I don't know. I never thought that I would be attacked by the government, like frontally, that he would use all his Twitter bots against me and then several other women. I think the government has a tendency to try to attack women consistently. But how do I see myself? I don't know. It's a very hard question. One doesn't really zoom out and look at oneself. At least I don't. I don't know how to answer.
Petra, how much does it weigh on you that somehow in this last month, I mean, not this last month, but even before, since the Edge of Democracy, you have become a kind of spokesperson? People ask you about Brazil, the future of cinema, the future of Brazil, the future of democracy in Brazil. I mean, we've read many things, and it seems that people come to you and ask you about your country. I mean, does this somehow weigh on your shoulders as a kind of a plight, like that you have to answer for what's not working in your country, or what the hopes are of the younger generations to consider the situation of Brazilian politics? Does this has an effect on you as an artist, as a creator, of a person who would also love to maybe explore different areas of creativity and so on? Or do you accept this being challenged with being the spokesperson for your country?
I don't think I'm a spokesperson for my country, but I think it's a privilege to be able to have to express oneself and to be heard. and I tried to serve that privilege however I can, at the same time that I'm trying now to find a balance, because I also need to focus on creating something else, an unrelated film that I'm not going to talk about right now. But so I have to also empty the mind as of the past and forget the edge of democracy to create something else. And that's the challenge in such a heated moment, where the film seems to not have ended at the same time.
So you say you don't want to talk about your next project, but can you maybe say what you are looking for when you're starting a new project? What is the this element that makes you start the project? Does it come from something personal, or does it come from something external from you? Is it a feeling? Is it a book, or what? How does it start?
Usually, for me, it's a mixture. But books have inspired me a lot, and I think all of my films had a book inspiration, and this one too, and also it will also be, I'm all again doing an investigation into parts of my memory, so trying to again dig and redig and redig and redig and see what comes out of that. And for that you need a lot of introspection, which is the opposite of being tuned in into the current affairs.
In this conversation, you mentioned obviously Glauber Rocha, and you produced a film about Hector Babenco. But would you expand a bit on what are the other influences or films that you loved in the tradition and the history of Brazilian cinema?
Mm-hmm. Glauber, I think, is really amazing. I think. I recently saw again Black God, White Devil, and it's masterful. And so is Entranced Earth. Whoever hasn't seen Entranced Earth, please watch it. And I really like the work of my contemporary Kleber Mendonça, Bacurau and Neighboring Sounds, especially. Gabriel Mascaro, Divine Love, and Boy Neon, and before Domestica. Gabriel and I tend to release films at the same times that we've done a few festival circuits together, and I really love his work, both in documentary and in fiction. João Moreira Salles, that we spoke about, and Eduardo Coutinho, who, since Cabra Marcado para Morrer, his first famous documentary, until O Fim e o Princípio, Edifício Master. He is a master interviewer. I don't think I know any other interviewer good as him, that manages to extract the soul of his subjects. Foreign Land by Walter Salles, I think, is a very beautiful film that I recommend watching, whoever hasn't watched. And there's a recent documentary, Piripicura, by Mariana Oliva, that is about this indigenous tribe of two people that had never been contacted, which is also quite beautiful documentary, contemporary. And I really like the work of Vincent Carelli, which is not as well known outside of Brazil, but he's been filming indigenous communities in Brazil for ages now, and both helps them film by creating a program called Vídeo nas Aldeias, where he gives cameras to several indigenous communities and has made beautiful documentaries about them, such as Martírio. and Jorge Bodansky, who did Iracema, Uma Transamazônica, and also The Third Millennium, which is an amazing documentary about a senator from the Amazon. It's worth watching now that the Amazon is in vogue again. And Rodrigo Siqueira, who's a contemporary documentary filmmaker who did The Earth Takes, The Earth Gives Back, and Orestes, about the legacy of the military dictatorship in Brazil. But if you want, I can continue. Also, the beautiful documentary by Marcelo Gomes and Karin Ainus, I Travel Because I Have To, I Return Because I Love You, which is an essay film about a truck driver that goes to the northeast of Brazil and writing a letter to his loved one. Madame Satan of Karin Ainus, Cinema Aspirina Urubus of Marcelo Gomes. They're Karin is from Ceará and Marcelo is from Pernambuco. A lot has come out from there.
Okay, I mean, we...
And the films of Caio Guimarães, my conterrâneo from Minas Gerais, is also really worth watching. Caio Guimarães is in the border of experimental visual art with documentary filmmaking.
Mm-hmm. We have another question, maybe, and it says, thank you for your wonderful films, Petra. You have a very personal approach and often includes your close ones. How do you reconcile this aspect of including the close ones in your films with yourself and the other people depicted in the films? I guess that somehow you already answered this question, but maybe from this you would like to sum it up for Kadrian.
Mm-hmm. It depends so much on the story, right? I think once you start, I at least start making a story, I become hostage to the story. So it's not like I decide the balance of things. It's more like I try to hear what the story wants and then I try to serve it. And then many times you have to kill your darlings, as Faulkner says, like... There are scenes that you love, but that the story dictates that they can't stay. And you have to submit. And sometimes it can be very painful.
Well, I mean, it's 2.5 hours we've been talking and discussing with Petra, and we have taken many questions from the audience, and if you want to add something else that we haven't touched upon, or Delphine, what do you think?
Well, one thing that has been really alive in the public debate in Brazil is like, how does a country that has more than half of its population that is Black have only 1% of its films directed by Black people? And it's a huge contradiction that needs to be addressed and funded and changed. And there is an active Black community in filmmaking in Brazil that has been very vocal and really setting forth and provoking these norms. And I hope that will change quickly. I really hope, because there's so much, so many stories that need to be told. There's already a community in Minas Gerais that have been making powerful stories, and there are many stories here and there. And that's one of the main challenges I see for Brazilian filmmaking in the next years, to address this abyss, this contradiction, this complete misrepresentation that exists in our film landscape.
Yeah, because in the music during the tropicalism revolution and so on, I mean, the voices were much very much diversified with Gilberto, Milton, and all the other people, and also later musicians like Javan. So when we think of Brazilian music, we always see it as a multi-identity, but cinema is really just white.
Yes.
So I mean, this is really an issue. And do you have any news about maybe filmmakers that of African descent that are coming or working or making short movies, or it's still a long way to come?
I mean, there are, and a lot. There are many short films made, and recent and feature films. There is Lázaro Ramos, the actor who directed a film that I think has not come out yet, and who is the actor in Madame Satan, Karine Aynou's film, and Jefferson D, who directed Brother, and M8, I think. Brother, I watched. M8, I haven't seen. But there's so much more to come. And I know that Ford Foundation has been tackling that and funding more of that. And I think if Brazilian cinema wouldn't have had the coup it had now, there were more and more initiatives that were addressing that issue that were being put forth, but now got arrested. So I really hope that we will relive good times again soon.
And there is also another community, which is the LGBTQ community, that is also quite pushed downwards nowadays in cinema, yes, but also in other arts, of course.
Yes, totally. But there have been more films directed by LGBTQ communities here, I think. But yes, they're constantly attacked by Bolsonaro. Our first gay congressman is living in exile, Jean Willis, because of he's in the film, and he was kind of the arch enemy of Bolsonaro in Congress. And in the tragic event, many people thought, oh, Jean would maybe become grow, but no, actually Bolsonaro grew, and Jean had to go to exile.
And we had in Visions du Réel a couple of films coming from this LGBTQT+ reality from Brazil. So, even Maria Ripp's films O Meu Corpo es Político that we showed in Visions du Réel, and some other films. So that's a reality of which we as Visions du Réel are quite aware of. Unfortunately, we all are looking forward to have voices from the African community or the descendants from the African community in Brazil making their films. And I think that it's peculiar that the heritage of the slavery in Brazil has been, by the ruling class, so dismissed, and they don't want to accept and look into this heritage, which is the heritage on which the wealth of Brazil has been built on.
Yes, and much of this impeachment and this political crisis is of a racist motivation. I think people undermine how much of a conflict and a unease was created by the fact that public universities became 50% people of African descent, and also there were laws to people for giving much more rights to domestic workers, and these started to put the racism inside people's houses, like to create, because what Brazil never institutionalized its racism like the United States, so it could never fight against its racism. And when that racism starts to have conflict, where they start to dispute the same public space, like universities, then it revives, it gains another, it's reawoken in a very perverse way.
Well, again, if there are more questions from the audience, we think we can stop here. I don't know what you think, Delphine.
Yeah, I think it's a nice moment to stop and to remember also that the films of Petra Costa can still be watched online, of course, on Doc Alliance Film and on Netflix as well, and this masterclass will be also
available
afterwards with French subtitles, if I'm not wrong, and with the excerpts. So you can, for the people who join us in the middle, they can still watch the beginning of it if they want. So thank you very much, Petra, for joining us and for giving us so much time and for your very generous answers. It was a very nice moment.
Yes.
Thank you. Thank you for your patience and bearing with us, because it's still very early and you still had a big day beginning with all these questions and answering. I think you deserve our rich, rich breakfast or a brunch.
Yes. Thank you, Jonah. Thank you, Delphine. Thank you, Emily. Thank you for Vision Jrel and everyone who was hearing us here. I really appreciate it.
And keep up the good work. We are looking forward for your new films, both as a director and as a producer.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. And thanks thank also all the people that have been so kind and following us for all the questions. And obviously we apologize because we couldn't ask all the questions, but we tried as much as possible to mix different questions together in order to ask as many as possible to Petra. Thank you again, all of you, for having made this masterclass with Petra Costa such a wonderful moment of Visions du Réel. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye. Thank you very much. Bye.
Bye.
Bye-bye.